Sige, so hello guys, recording na tayo. Magandang gabi, no? For those newbies that who are joining this or who are joining this ano ba tawag ito? Call. Maybe you're wondering why na bakit tayo nagtatagalog kasi si Robbi, yung ating guest ay ano po siya? He is Tagalog. Yun yung language na ginagamit niya.
Kasabot ko gamay Bisaya.
kasabot sa gamay Bisaya, which is good. So currently what for today's session, now we have been doing this for, this is actually the third session. The first was about how earnings affect stock prices and our investment decisions. That's the very first topic, no? And sa mga newbies or sa mga bago pa nag-join sa course, don't worry about it because meron din siya sa ating group. Yung entire session ni Robbi nandun sa group natin. And you can also watch it there. Yung second session naman is about Q&A, no? Question and answer portion, about the first session. So yun. And then ngayon na naman, ang pag-usapan natin is value investing. All right. For those people who don't know value investing, this is like the very big thing that Warren Buffett is doing. And he is, if you don't know Warren Buffett, he is our brother-in-law. No? Eh, hindi lang. No. Ano siya? He's the guy na grabe, marami yung alam pagdating sa investing. All right. So now we have the privilege to have Mr. Robbi Samson again of First Metro Securities to talk about value investing, no? Para may matutunan naman tayo ngayon about the stock market. Okay? So, I'm going to give the floor to Robbi. If you have any questions, you can type it down sa chat room natin, or later we can also unmute you para you can ask him directly kung ano yung mga tanong mo. Anything about stock market, kaya ni Robbi. All right? And if there's something that I also want to share, mag-share lang din ako. Pero most of the highlights or the spotlight is on him. Okay? Sige. So boss, welcome again and thank you so much for your time. And we are all excited to learn something new from you na naman. No? So go ahead. Go
for it. Thanks, bro. So hi everyone. No? So good evening. And I'm happy to be here once again to talk to you about some of the things that we would benefit from learning about the stock market, about investing. No? So, yun. So again, we're going to talk about some value investing tips. Sabi nga ni Sir Jan, it's going to be from the perspective of someone who is a long-term investor. So, yeah. So I'd like to share my presentation. Ah. So, ayan. Okay. Ayan. So, value investing basics. Kitang-kita natin sa picture, no? Si Warren Buffett because he's like the poster child for value investing. He's one of the most popular, most successful investors in the whole world. And it definitely will benefit us to learn a little bit about how he approaches investing. Again, the beauty of the stock market is that it can cater to all of your investing styles. Whether short-term, long-term ka, merong perfect na information that will suit your investing style the most, no? The best. So, yun. So, that's what we're trying to learn here with this series. So, again, ako si Robbi Samson, no, yung business development section head for Mindanao for First Metro Securities. And yeah, these are some of my accolades lang. I am a licensed stock broker, a licensed mutual fund solicitor, both are licenses by the SEC, Bloomberg certified financial markets professional. And yon. So just to prove na hindi nga kailangan finance guy ka talaga, I graduated industrial engineering from Ateneo de Davao and I also completed my MBA there, no. So yun. So let's move on, no. So ang goal natin this evening is to learn more about value investing. So it might be a good idea for us to first define, no, it might be a good idea to first define ano ba yung value investing na yan. So para mas ma, especially if you haven't started investing yet, para mas ma-appreciate natin yung ano, mas ma-appreciate natin yung meaning niya. Let's look at this example, no. Let's say gusto mo bumili ng TV, Sony na TV, 'di ba? Gusto mo bumili ng Sony na TV. And let's say right now, sabihin natin 50,000 pesos siya. No, 50,000 pesos siya. Pero since ikaw medyo veterano ka na sa pagpapamili ng appliances, alam mo na at some point in time during the year, si Sony magse-sale yan. Di ba? Magse-sale yan. Magse-sale yan. And so, yung ibinebenta niyang TV ngayon na worth 50,000 pesos, siguro pagka Araw ng Dabaw, pagka Kadayawan, pagka Pasko, magse-sale yan, baka mabili mo siya ng mas murang sa mas murang halaga. So baka mabili mo siya instead of 50,000, you might be able to buy it for 30,000, 40,000. And so ikaw as a value investor, you want to be able to buy you it would be better for you to be able to buy this TV, the same exact TV at a lower price. 'Di ba? So gusto natin 'yon. Kaya nga 'di ba pagka nag-sale sa mga malls, whether damit, sapatos, appliances, stuff like that, dinudumog talaga siya ng tao. Bakit? Kasi alam ng tao, mabibili nila yung gusto nilang item at a lower price. You would get the same exact item but at a cheaper price. So that's exactly what value investing is. Ita-transport lang natin siya to the world of the stock market, but essentially, the principles remain the same. You want to be able to buy stocks that you like at cheaper prices. You don't want to buy it at fair value or at the suggested retail price, di ba? Ayaw natin yun kasi gusto natin mabili siya at a discounted price. Ang difference lang sa stock market, medyo mahirap makuha yung trend. Hindi natin alam kung kailan siya babagsak. Unlike dito sa mga appliances na to, medyo may trend yan, di ba? Pagka, lalo ngayon with the advent of online shopping, di ba? Parang it seems like every month there is a sale. 4-4, 5-5, 6-6, 7-7, yung mga Lazada, Shopee. So medyo makukuha mo yung trend. And so, medyo mas madali mag-ipon ng pera kasi alam mo, makakabili ka at a cheaper price later on. The thing about the stock market is, prices will definitely go down. We just don't know when exactly. And so, yun yung nagiging problema ng ibang investors. They get too overexcited because they believe na, uy, this seems like a good entry point. Without studying much about the economy, about the market. And so they buy only to see the stock market go down further. Diba? So ganon. So kaya tayo mag-session here tonight, we want to be able to understand ano ba yung mga indicators na pwede nating magamit para magkaroon tayo ng better idea kung kailan natin masasabi na nakasale na talaga siya at sulit na talaga siya bilhin. So this is an extension of what we learned last week, no? Which is the PE ratio and the earnings per share. So this is another way. Kasi yung PE ratio, earnings per share, if you'll remember, it was used mostly to identify momentum. Diba? Growth potential. So pag mataas ang PE ratio at mataas ang EPS compounded annual growth rate mo, you like it because that means the demand is there. No, the income, the sales are there for the company, and on the part of the investors, the demand is there, kaya umaakyat yung PE ratio mo. This time naman, medyo yung baliktad ang hahanapin natin. Ano ba yung mura? Ano ba yung undervalued? Gusto natin ang undervalued kasi gusto natin makabili ng mga stocks sa mas mabababang presyo. So paano ba natin masasabi na nasa mas mabababang presyo sila? So let's look at these four examples. So these are all taken from First MetroSec Pro. So these are all screenshots of that. And let's look at this. So yung mga red and green na mga prices na yan, yung mga malalaking font, those are the current market prices of the different companies. No? And so on the right side naman, you will see, andun yung consensus target. So ano ba yung ibig sabihin ng consensus target? Yung mga consensus targets na yan, yan na yung tinatawag natin na supposed fair value of these companies. So what do we mean by that? Let's look at Philippine National Bank, PNB first. Right now, ang current market price niya is 22.85 pesos per share. No, 22.85 pesos per share. And according to the consensus target on the right, which is meron yung tatlong consensus prices dyan, the low, the average, and the high. So pag sinabi nating low, consensus means these are the collective analysis and recommendations and findings of different top brokers in the country. So usually more than 10 yan. Pagka naging consensus yan, usually more than 10 brokers. So ibig sabihin natin 10. So ibig sabihin, pag sinabi mong low, out of the 10 brokers that analyzed, no, PNB, the lowest broker, the broker that gave it the lowest fair price is 38 pesos per share. Meaning, tingin nila, ang dapat na presyo ni PNB, 38 pesos per share. So, 22.85 siya, pero dapat ang presyo niya 38, undervalued siya. Diba? Mas mura siya. Parang yung TV lang ulit, 50,000 ng TV, alam natin kasi ang original price sa tag niya, 50,000. Pero ngayon, mabibili natin ng 30,000. So, mas mura siya by 20,000 pesos. So, yun yung low. Ibig sabihin, this is the lowest price that a broker gave PNB as its fair value. Yung fair value, yan yung parang pwede nating sabihin, yan yung dapat na presyo ni PNB. Based on its assets, based on its liabilities, based on its income potential, based on its earnings growth, based on a lot of different factors, this should be the price of PNB, 38 pesos. Pag sinabi naman nating average, essentially, that's just the average of the different fair value targets of the 10 brokers. So the average is 61.17 pesos per share. And the highest fair value target given by a broker is 75.82 pesos per share. So as an investor, nasa sa atin na yan kung ano ang gusto nating gawing target dyan. Tayo yung magde-decide. So definitely, kung conservative tayo, we would say na, uy, if PNB reaches 38 pesos, I might consider selling. Because I want to make sure. Diba? Pagka naman medyo aggressive kayo, tingin ninyo, uy, I will believe the most bullish analyst out there. And I will sell PNB when it reaches 75. So that's, at this point in time, that's more than 3 times its current price. Di ba? So malaki-laking upside yun, times 3 ng pera mo yun. So, ganun yung pag-intindi mo ngayon dito sa consensus target na to. So essentially, what we're seeing, but for simplicity's sake, let's use the average prices. So what we're saying here is that PNB is currently being traded at 22.85, but its price should be 61 pesos per share. So it is trading at a discount. There is value in it because it is undervalued. So good siya. The same thing with Manila Water. Price niya 12.7, consensus average 18. Same with Ayala Land. 32 siya ngayon, pero ang consensus target niya, consensus average niya, 50 pesos. And Cebu Pacific, 44.5 pesos lang siya right now, pero ang consensus target niya, 90 pesos per share. So yun yung ibig sabihin nun. However, hindi porket meron tayong ganitong guide, this is all we need in order to make investment decisions. No. we have to incorporate some more analysis aside from this in order to come to a good decision. So, let's look at this example, no? Bakit, ano naman ang value ng pag-spot ng undervalued na share? So, let's look at the chart of Ayala Land from 2007 until today, no? So, makikita natin dito, Ayala Land, back in 2007, it was trading at 17 pesos per share. 17 pesos per share, yung first na pink circle dyan. And then, nung nag-recession, global financial crisis, di ba? The last recession that we had, nung subprime loans na nag-default, the market went down. And so, of course, si Ayala Land, bumagsak siya. From 17.7 pesos, it went to as low as 5.51 pesos per share. So, that represented a loss of nearly 70%. Di ba? So, kung nag-invest ka ng 100,000 kay Ayala Land, 30,000 na lang yung pera mo after about 2 years. So, ganun ka-steep yung drop. Now, dito ngayon papasok yung pagiging value investor natin. Di ba sabi nga natin, ang gusto natin sa value investing, makabili kung kailan mura ang isang stock. Pero ibig sabihin ba nun, katulad ngayon, no? Katulad ngayon, kaya I used, if you'll recall, I used the last two examples, Ayala Land, Cebu Pacific, because you have to incorporate some analysis into it, no? So, let's look at this for Ayala Land. Bumagsak from 17 to 5 pesos si Ayala Land, what do you do? Just because ba it went down by 70%, the thing that you will do is immediately buy it? Kasi mas mura na siya? Hindi. Diba? Hindi yon. Hindi porket bumagsak siya, bibilin mo na siya agad. Kasi pwedeng bumagsak siya, pero baka hindi na siya maka-recover. So you have to understand, bumagsak itong kumpanya na ito, pero tingin ko ba may chance, may good chance siyang makarecover in the future? Because that is not always a given. Hindsight is always 20-20, kaya ngayon madali nating makita na, uy, magandang bumili pala sana dati ng Ayala Land. Because now we know that it really went up, no, to where it is today at around 32 pesos. So, we have to understand, at this point, back in 2009, we had to decide, tingin ko ba si Ayala Land makaka-recover pa? And if so, that's the time you buy. And later on, we will talk about the different ways we can analyze this. But supposing, no? Supposing that we did buy Ayala Land because we believe that it's a good company, maganda ang management niya, eventually, makaka-recover naman ng economy. At eventually, gugustuhin ng mga tao, di ba? Ang magiging trend is, gugustuhin ng mga tao, humiwalay kung saan sila nakatira. Di ba? So, especially in the case of Luzon, na nasa NCR ang karamihan ng magagandang trabaho or yung mga prestigious na jobs. So, ang nangyayari, yung mga taga-probinsya, diba? Kaya nga may plans yung government to decongest, eh, diba? Kasi ang karamihan ng mga tao sa Luzon nagtatrabaho sa Metro Manila. And so, property prices went up because there was a surge in demand at those areas. Dinevelop siya, condos, subdivisions, lahat yan pinagkakitaan ni Ayala Land. Office buildings, lahat yan pinagkakitaan ni Ayala Land. And so, it went from 550 in 2009 to 32.65 today, which is an increase of about 500%. So, malaki-laki yung in-increase niya. And if you had caught it at 5.5 because you thought it was undervalued, you would have made 500% in just 10 short years, no? 10 short years. So, yun yung potential. Kaya a lot of people, even Warren Buffett, they find time to identify undervalued companies because if they recover, you stand to make a lot of money. You really stand to make a lot of money. Pero itong next example, this is a very good example of why we need to analyze things. No, kasi ngayon, especially ngayong nagka-pandemic, no, ang daming stocks ang bumagsak sa presyo. Ang daming stocks ang bumagsak, no? Even Ayala Land, you can see back in 2019, it was trading at around 50 pesos per share. Now it's at 32. So bumagsak na siya. Pero ibig sabihin ba, porket bumagsak si Ayala Land, automatically bibili natin siya? So we have to analyze. Why is it important? Because these things happen. So look at this. Ah. This is a recent development. And this is a development from Warren Buffett. So back in March 13, 2020, di ba value investor si Sir Warren Buffett. So ang sabi niya, since bumagsak ang presyo ng mga airline stocks kasi nga they were feared to be one of the victims of lockdowns and virus transfers kasi nga enclosed area. So maraming natakot mag-travel sa kanila. So what happened? Airline stocks crashed, no? Not just in the Philippines in the case of Cebu Pacific and PAL, but also all over the world. Mga Delta Airlines, ganyan, bumagsak lahat yan. So back in March 13, 2020, sabi ni Warren Buffett, he started buying airline stocks. He said, I won't be selling airline stocks. No? So very, very inspiring yun. Nakaka-inspire ng confidence yun because Warren Buffett, a master investor, said, I won't be selling airline stocks. Fast forward to a few days ago, what happened? Nagbenta si Warren Buffett. So si Warren Buffett, definitely, nung binili niya yung airline stock, since value investor siya, he bought it when it was cheap. He bought it when it was cheap. But how come, if he bought it when it was cheap, how come he is selling just less than 2 months later? And he claims to have made a mistake. Because meron ng fundamental change dun sa investments niya. Diba? Meron ng fundamental change. Maybe he anticipates that this virus, this lockdown, is going to last longer than most of us think. Maybe it's going to be harder and harder for airlines to turn a profit. Kasi nga, the airline industry already is very competitive, tas ang hirap pa kumita dyan, di ba? So, usually, ang profitable lang na mga airline companies are the budget airlines because they are the ones that are able to cram a lot of people into a single plane, di ba? Tsaka mabilis yung turnaround time nila, kaya madami silang flights in one day. Pero, because of the virus, what happened to the airline industry? Definitely ngayon, magpa-practice ka ng social distancing sa loob ng aeroplano. Which means, baka hindi na pwede yung, di ba yung mga aeroplano dati, 3-seaters, tapos dalawang rows. Baka hindi na pwedeng magkakatabi kayong tatlo. Baka in one aisle, baka in one 3-seat block, isang tao na lang ang pwede sumakay dyan. So that's just 1/3 of the capacity of all of your planes. So just imagine, you would lose 2/3 of your revenues. That's just from the number of passengers that will ride your planes. Eh, how much more yung number of flights pa? Mababawasan yan. Kasi the demand will definitely be slower during the, especially habang wala pang vaccine. So because of all of those factors, kahit nakabili si Warren Buffett ng airline stocks at cheap prices, he still sold less than 2 months later because he doesn't think that the airline industry will be the same at the very least in the medium term, no? Kasi si Warren Buffett, pagka nag-invest yan, laging long term yan. Hindi yan nag-i-invest para ibenta after 1 month, 2 months. So, ibig sabihin, yung perception niya sa airline industry might be bearish for the medyo long term. Maybe 2 years, 3 years, 4 years or more. So, ganon. Kaya siya nagbenta. So, ibig sabihin lang, ang point lang dito, hindi ibig sabihin na mura ang stock, automatically, bibilin mo siya. So that's something. No. So, what are the value investing principles, no, that you need to learn about if you want to be a value investor? ang kagandahan kasi sa pagiging value investor, medyo hindi mo kailangan ganun katutok sa market, no? Hindi mo kailangan katutok sa market. Why? Because number one, if you're a value investor, you are seeking a high enough margin of safety. What do we mean by that? Gusto mo, bibili ka lang pagka murang-mura na talaga yung stock. Gaano ka mura, that depends on you. Yung iba kasi, ang gusto nila, dapat 30% discount to the fair value. Yung nakita nating fair value earlier, di ba? Some people want 30% discount. Why? Because they think that if I buy a stock at a 30% discount, that already gives me a lot of room for upside while also making sure that my risk is minimized. Because the lower you go, especially if you believe in it for the long term, kasi the only reason you would buy a stock is if you still believe in it for the long term. So that gives you a good margin of safety. You can make 30% if you are correct, but you will only lose 3%, 5% if you are wrong. So that's why it's important, no? Another thing, value investors utilize inefficient markets. So what do we mean by that? Yung mga value investors kasi, they believe that markets are not efficient. Meaning, the stock price of a stock doesn't fully reflect everything that all the information that the public knows about it. So sa madaling salita, pagka naniniwala kang inefficient ang market, ibig sabihin nun, tingin mo, nag-overreact talaga ang mga tao. Meaning, because of paranoia, because of fear, because of depression, because of whatever negative sentiment there is, they can sell a stock down to unbelievably low prices. Yung tipong sobrang mura na, paano umabot sa ganitong presyo itong mga stocks na to? So you believe that. In the same way, you also believe that the prices of stocks can reach very, can become so high that they also become unreasonable naman. Mostly because of sentiment. So ibig sabihin nun, inefficient yung market. And ikaw, as a value investor, your primary goal is to take advantage of those market inefficiencies. Kaya nga, if you'll see at the next point, being a value investor means you are being a contrarian. So ano yung meaning ng contrarian? Itong quote sa gilid. So, be fearful when others are greedy and be greedy when others are fearful. So, to put it mildly, when the market crashed in March, no, when the PSEI went to as low as 4,000, value investors were happy. Value investors were happy. Value investors were buying. Why? Because they saw value. They are greedy when others are fearful. And when everyone is buying, they are selling. So that's their nature. And because of that, no, value investors, they tend to be long-term investors talaga. They don't plan on holding it for 6 months. They don't just plan on holding it for 1 year. They plan on holding it for the long term. And so, they treat investing in the stock market as if they are true owners of the company, which they are naman talaga. But others kasi, di ba, they get into the stock market in order to trade the stock market. So they buy now, and then after a few days, they sell. So that's how they play the stock market. But value investors, they treat themselves as owners of the company, no? As true stakeholders of the company. And so what they do, they find out a lot about the company in order to make the best decision possible. So those are the value investing principles that we need to learn about. And because of that, if you want to be a value investor, one thing that you have to know about is you have to know the company that you are interested in buying. You have to know a lot about it. And one of the approaches that you can use is what we call the top-down approach. So what is the top-down approach? So basically, you analyze it from the top all the way to the specific company that you are invested in buying. No? So first, you look at the global economy. Yeah, you look at the global economy. So right now, coronavirus, global and local economy are almost the same right now. We're dealing with the same problems. And so you look at the global economy, things are not looking good. Yeah, things are not looking good. We've read of reports that say we might be entering into a recessionary period. We don't even know how long it will last. So now that you've analyzed the global economy and the local economy, the next thing that you need to learn about is which sectors will benefit or which sectors will be able to withstand the negative events that will potentially happen to the economy in the near future. So, anong sectors yon? So, dyan papasok ngayon yung mga sectoral picks like mga manufacturing, industrials, stuff like that. After looking at the sector, you look at the industry. So, sa manufacturing, what specifically? No? What specifically are the manufacturers that we need to be looking at? Right now, pwedeng tingin mo, yung mga nagmamanufacture ng mga essentials, ng mga essential goods, like yung mga food, di ba? Yung mga grocery items, mga chips, semiconductors, and chips for mga ventilators, stuff like that. And then, after looking at the industry, you now move on to which specific company should benefit at this particular time. And that's the time you will be able to arrive at your list of candidates. So you will be able to narrow down from the 300 plus listed companies in the PSE, you would be able to narrow it down to a select few. And once you've been able to narrow it down, we can now employ yung mga EPS, PE ratio, book value, ROE, we can incorporate those in our analysis to come to the best decision possible to find out exactly which company should we be investing in. So, ganun siya. So, the two formulas, the two figures that we'll be discussing here tonight are the following, no? So, the price to book ratio and the return on equity. So the price to book ratio, essentially we computed stock price, which is the market price, divided by the total assets less your liabilities. So yan. So ano ba yung importance, no? Ano ba yung importance ng price to book? The price to book actually is a way for us to measure the value of a stock. Dito natin makikita gaano ba siya kamahal or gaano ba siya kamura. No? So yun yung assumption natin when it comes to the price to book. And the next one is the return on equity. Ito naman, net income divided by shareholders' equity. This figure naman determines how efficient the management is in turning your equity into profits. No, gaano sila ka-efficient. So this is a very, very important number. This is a popular number amongst long-term investors kasi this goes to show us gaano ba kagaling yung management ng kumpanya na gusto natin pag-investan. Kaya ba nilang pakitain yung kumpanya? So essentially, the higher your return on equity, the better. So I won't go down into the nitty-gritty of the derivation of this, no? But I want to show lang how we can possibly use it when it comes to making investment decisions. So this is actually a report that is generated weekly by First Metro. This is called the Stock Screen Report. This is our latest one, so it's dated May 5. So it was released last Wednesday lang. This one, it gives you a select criteria and stock picks from that particular criteria. So this is very relevant to our discussion here this evening. This is called the value play criteria. And paano natin maipapasok ang isang stock dito sa value play category na to? As you can see above, the stock needs to have a low price to book value But aside from that, it also has to have a high return on equity. Yan. So let's look at Maxess, no? Let's look at Maxess right now. Maxess, as we can see, the price to book ratio niya is 0.8 times lang. Meaning, if the company liquidates itself, it has the price is very, very undervalued na. No, the price would more than be able to cover the assets, no, the liabilities of this company. So this one, Maxess, pagka 0.8, pagka kasi less than 1 ang price to book mo, usually, generally, they consider it undervalued. So ganun siya. Aside from that, mataas ang return on equity. So this return on equity, 12.6%, we need to compare it against the peers. So we will have an example here later. But that's our goal here for this evening. How do we understand better this particular report para alam natin paano ba gagamitin itong value play na picks na to na report ni First Metro Securities. No? So in the case of Maxess, right now it's trading at 6.5 pesos per share. The target price is 10 pesos. And ang ibig sabihin nito, these are stocks that are undervalued by the market but are able to provide high return to shareholders. So medyo dito papasok yung pagiging inefficient ng market. Malakas kumita itong kumpanya na to, profitable siya, pero for some reason, hindi siya pinapansin ng investors. Kasi ang baba pa din ng presyo niya. So ganun yung ibig sabihin nun. So again, the value play. So there are four categories. No? There are four categories in the stock screen report. But for value play specifically, ang ibig sabihin niya, below average price to book ratio, pero above average return on equity. So that's what we are looking at. So let's look at Ayala Land. No? Similar to what we did last week with the PE ratio, with the EPS, if you still remember, we don't just take it at face value. Hindi porket makita natin na, in this case, Ayala Land, price to book niya is 2.28. On its own, we don't really know how to use it properly, di ba? It's very hard to know how to use it properly if it's just 2.28. What does 2.28 mean? So what we do, and what we did last week with the EPS, we compared it against different measures, no? We compared it against its peers. We compared it against its sector. We compared it against its historical performance. So in this case, for Ayala Land, ang price to book niya right now is 2.28. So, 2.28, if you compare it to Maxess, ano siya? Mataas siya. Pero Ayala Land is not Maxess. Ayala Land is definitely more popular than Maxess. And also, yung book value kasi, it usually only captures the tangible assets. It mostly ignores the intangible assets. So, yung mga intangibles kasi yun na yung goodwill, yung mga patents mo, yung mga, ayun, yung hindi siya tangible, no? But still, they contribute to the earnings of your company. And si Ayala Land, definitely being a premier real estate company, may value yung brand name niya. And that is not fully captured by the book value. Kaya mahirap i-compare yung sa Maxess ako mag-i-invest kasi mas kikita ako dyan kasi mas mababa ang book value, mas mura siya. So you cannot compare the two. Kaya it might be better to compare the price to book ratio of Ayala Land with its previous values. And right now, Ayala Land has a price to book ratio of 2.28. Pero we can see here dun sa ilalim, the historical price to book ratio ni Ayala Land was always above 3. Diba? So it's always above 3. So from that perspective alone, currently, this is the latest price of Ayala Land. So from that perspective alone, we can see that, uy, when compared to its 5-year average of more than 3, Ayala Land right now seems to be undervalued. Diba? Ayala Land right now seems to be undervalued because its price to book ratio right now is just at 2.28. So because of that ba, we already buy? As we saw earlier in the example with Warren Buffett, hindi pwedeng ganun lang. We have to understand, no, or we have to decide, what do we believe will be the case for Ayala Land 5 years from now, 10 years from now? Will it be able to go back to its previous performance? Will it be able to recover from this pandemic? And because of its recovery, will it eventually go back to being having a price-to-book ratio of above 3 times? So yun yung mga tatanungin natin. And so that will make you question, kumusta ba si Ayala Land? Diba? You will now think of different scenarios. Like, right now, Ayala Land, andyan yung mga BPOs, yung mga office spaces. So you'll think, if i-implement ba ang work from home, if magtatagal ba itong virus na to, and i-implement ang work from home, will it be good for Ayala Land? Or will it cause Ayala Land to really suffer to the point na they might close down some offices or their tenants might leave because their tenants are the ones that closed down? So yung mga ganun yung tatanungin mo. Yung mga malls niya, makaka-recover ba? So if you say na, uy, yes, I believe naman 5 years from now, okay pa din si Ayala Land. Then you might say, mura nga siya right now. Kasi you believe it will eventually be able to recover and go back to its previous levels of having a price-to-book value of more than 3 times. So, ganun siya. So, we can use it that way. Baliktad naman siya kay Cebu Pacific. So, ganun naman din. Cebu Pacific, same thing. Price-to-book ratio ni Cebu Pacific, 0.64. So, you don't compare it to the price-to-book of Ayala Land kasi they belong to different industries. And because of that, minsan may industries kasi na highly leveraged, meron namang iba, hindi masyado. So, hindi mo pwedeng i-compare against two different companies, entirely different companies yung price-to-book ratio. So, again, let's compare it to its historical performance. From 2015 until 2019, naglalaro between 1 and 2 ang price-to-book ratio ni Cebu Pacific. Right now, it's at 0.64. So, possibly, this is also one of the reasons why Warren Buffett decided to invest in airline stocks earlier, di ba? Or the reason why he said he wouldn't be selling airline stocks because he believed they would eventually recover. They are trading at low prices right now. He will buy because he believes they will recover later. So definitely, he considered the price to book as one of his indicators in his decision making. So, if we only use price-to-book ratio alone, we would see na, uy, Cebu Pacific seems to be a good buy. Kasi sa consensus target, ang average niya, 90 pesos, meaning doble ang upside ko. Tapos ang price-to-book niya, 0.64 pa. Eh, ang average niya, nasa 1.3, 1.4. So, it is trading at a discount to its price, historical price-to-book ratio. So, does that already mean we will buy Cebu Pacific? So, that will be up to you. No? If you believe that the airline industry will be able to recover sooner rather than later, or that there will be no irreparable damage to the company 5 years from now, then go ahead and buy Cebu Pacific. Pero if you believe na, uy, hindi natin alam kung hanggang kailan magtatagal itong virus na to, what if, sana wag naman, pero what if mag second wave? Tapos, yun nga, yung sinabi ko earlier that there will definitely be social distancing measures imposed in airplane flights. So that will affect the revenue, I believe. Diba, several airlines already have started laying off their people. Diba, they have laid off their people. So, ang pag-layoff kasi ng mga tao, that's usually one of the last resorts of corporations. They will try other means to get back on their feet, but when worst comes to worst, they have no choice but to lay off people. So that's a sign of desperation on the part of corporations. So that goes to say a lot about the airline or the tourism industry as a whole, especially with the news yesterday that Marco Polo would be indefinitely stopping their operations starting on June, diba? And then offering separation pays to their employees. So that goes to show you na, uy, the tourism industry in which hotels and airlines are part of, it's not looking as good as other industries siguro, diba? As other industries. So in that case, mag-hesitate ka bumili ng Cebu Pacific, even if you can see right now that the price-to-book ratio is definitely very, very low compared to its 5-year average. So, ganun siya. So, we can use it that way. So, aside from that, no, we can also look at the sector. So, this is the financial sector. And we can look at the different price-to-book ratios of the different banks here in the country. No, so, BDO has the highest price-to-book ratio because siguro mas confident lang talaga ang tao sa kanya. Mas may demand sa kanya. So, let's look at this. BDO is at 1.15, BPI 0.95, Metrobank 0.54. So, let's say you're considering investing in the banking sector kasi tingin mo, once na makaraos tayo sa virus na ito, sa pandemic na ito, then the economy will start to pick up because it is being supported din naman by the government, diba? The BSP is lowering interest rates. It's loosening its reserve rate requirement. These are all meant to spur economic activity. The BSP is doing this to generate more jobs, more businesses, more loans, stuff like that, to spur the economy. And when the economy is growing, banks are obviously going to be a big part of it because they will be the ones financing these projects. So, kunwari, ganun yung pinapaniwalaan mo. You believe that the banking sector, once this pandemic is done or once the recession ends, they will be able to recover. No? So, they won't close down. Perhaps they're too big to fail na. So, ngayon, namimili ka between the top three banks, BDO, BPI, and Metrobank. And you see that their price-to-book ratios are 1.15, 0.95, and 0.54. So, how do you decide, no? So you look at this, no? So we can, in addition to the price-to-book ratio, we can also incorporate the return on equity, which again is a measurement of the company's ability to generate profits for your shares, no? For their shareholders. So Metrobank right now, ang price-to-book niya again, 0.54, but we all see that its historical average was probably at around 1. No. So, ibig sabihin, it's trading at a nearly 50% discount to its average book value, no, price-to-book ratio. Aside from that, we can see here that ROE, return on equity, is at 9.46%. So, generally kasi 10 to 15% those are good. So, the higher, the better. That means you're able to generate more returns for your shareholders the higher they get. You also see the PE ratio. You see the PE ratio there, 6 times. So we can compare it against the average then if it's lower than the 5-year average in PE ratio. So here we can see PE ratio ni Metrobank 6 times right now. 2015 to 2019, it's always trading at about 10 times or above that. So definitely lower siya. From that perspective, lower siya. Price to book mo, lower din. Pero yung ROE mo, 9.46. So you compare it against its peers. So you look at the other banks. So BPI, price to book niya is what, 0.95. But the historical average should be at around 1.5. PE ratio niya, 8.92 times. It's still trading at a discount to its average, significant discount pa din. But yung return on equity niya, 11%. So it's higher. So it's a bit more profitable than Metrobank. Parang ganun yung indication itong ROE na to, na figure. BDO is not below 1. So si BPI, si Metrobank, parehong below 1 ang price to book. BDO naman, 1.15. And if you'll notice, ang PE ratio ni BDO, 10 times. Compared to 9 times of BPI and 6 times of Metrobank. So you can see here, BDO has always been more in demand than the other banking stocks because it tends to grow faster, it tends to grow higher, and as you can see from the return on equity, it generates more profits for shareholders. So that might be because of their network, di ba? Mas madami silang branches, mas visible yung mga locations ng branches nila kasi sila yung nasa loob ng mall. So stuff like that, they expand faster. So there are many reasons for this, no? But we can see here, price to book ni BDO, 1.15. And ang historical average niya was 1.88. Sabihin natin, nasa 1.9 ang average niya. So it's still trading at a discount. So now that you know all of those things, no, we can, in a way, we can conclude that all three banks are undervalued right now. All three banks are undervalued right now. Out of the three, it seems like BDO has been the most evident in generating profits for their shareholders, no? So, doon na tayo ngayon magde-decide which company do we think will be best positioned to recover faster when things get better. So these are the things. Do we go for the deep value, in which case si Metrobank ang piliin natin kasi siya talaga yung pinakamura kasi sobrang baba ng price to book ratio niya, 0.54 lang. Siya din ang may pinakamababang PE ratio. So siya siguro, if you're a value investor na talagang naghahanap ng sagad na margin of safety, pwedeng si Metrobank. Pagka naman ikaw yung aggressive, you're willing to pay a little bit of a premium in order to capture the what may be the best performing or the most in-demand stock between the three, you can select BDO. Kasi all of them naman are undervalued, pero this is the least undervalued of the three. Parang ganun yung ibig sabihin niya. No? So you now decide. You now decide whether to buy BDO, BPI, or Metrobank based on what you are when it comes to being an investor. Diba? Conservative, moderate, or aggressive. Or you can diversify between all three and allocate more to BDO because you think it might go faster. No? So parang ganun siya. Kasi we have to remember, we cannot base it just on ROE. We cannot base it just on price-to-book ratio. We have to, at the end of the day, prices go up, as we mentioned last week, prices go up because they are expected to make more money in the future. So that's one thing we cannot forget. Even if we're value investors, we have to look at the ability of the company to generate more earnings in the future. And which of the three is best positioned, that will be up to you to decide. Pero at least now, you have an idea. So parang ganun siya. So when it comes to incorporating it to the value play report that we put out weekly, pwedeng ganito yung tingin natin, no? So we can do it the same way. The price to earnings, the price to book value of Maxis right now is 0.8 according to the report, but according to the website, it's 1.13. So they come from different sources, they come from different time points din naman. So naiiba talaga siya, may discrepancy. But the important thing is, we can see here that it was usually trading above 1. No? So 2 siya nung 2019, 3.7, 5.49, 5. So medyo mataas siya. No, but right now it's deeply undervalued. So that's how you use it. But we have to always remember, no, we have to always remember these value plays are usually meant for the long term. So we have to really take into account how confident are we that this company will be able to recover in the future. So talagang hindi natin pwede gamitin yung mababang ROE, mababang PB ratio lang. Bibilin ko na siya. Kasi talagang it requires a lot more than that. We have to be sure that the company will be able to turn around after all this is said and done. And that's what Warren Buffett is very, very good at. Diba? He is able to discern the bad companies that are cheap from the good companies that are cheap. So yun yun. So because a lot of, believe me, you will find, if you look at the listed companies in the stock market, you will find a lot of companies there trading na mababa ang PE ratio, mababa ang book value, pero not all of them are profitable, not all of them have gone up. Why? Because they're just not that good of a company. So they're not able to turn around their operations. So dito, bibili tayo kasi may temporary weakness, may temporary sale in terms of their price. But we have to believe that they will be able to recover in the future. We cannot just buy them because they are cheap, in the cheap sense. We have to buy them because they are good companies that are selling cheaper. But they are good companies. Similar to our TV example nung umpisa, we are inclined to buy a Sony TV because we believe the quality is there. Diba? We believe the durability is there. And so if it comes from 50,000 to 30,000, we buy it because we know that we are getting the same quality and we will be able to use it for the same amount of time as when we bought it at 50,000. In the stock market, we have to do that as well. Kung mura ngayon si Cebu Pacific, kung kinoconsider mong bilhin si Cebu Pacific right now, you have to be sure that 5 years from now, Cebu Pacific will be able to recover. Kasi otherwise, if you are not sure, if you are not confident, then you might have just bought a stock that is cheap but could get even cheaper. So ganon. Kaya si Warren Buffett, nag-unload ng airline stocks because probably he believes that the turnaround may not come anytime soon. Or he is not sure when the turnaround will come. So we have to do it that way. And we factor in all of the different aspects of investing that we learned, earnings potential, the sector that they are operating in. Diba? So si Ayala Land, after ba mag-recession, may demand pa din yung mga tao for housing, for condos, for office space? Most likely, yes. hindi mababago yun. And it has been proven already in 2008 to 2009. Diba? Nung last recession, bumagsak din siya. At yun, medyo real estate link pa yung cost ng pagbagsak nun. Pero naka-recover si Ayala Land. Why? Because it's able to put a premium on its products because of its brand name, because of its large cash reserves, it is able to buy the best pieces of land out there. It is probably able to outbid others. It is probably able to easily they develop the locations, eh, diba? So kahit barren yung lugar na yan, they're able to develop it well and make money from it. So that's how powerful they are. That's how influential they are. So siguro, in the case of Ayala Land, medyo on the safer side tayo that they will be able to recover. But for the other companies out there, you have to think deeply. And this is even true for the popular stocks like Jollibee. Diba? Jollibee is going to be hard hit. We don't know how long social distancing will last. Right now, meron ng mga guidelines na dapat may social distancing in restaurants. So that will affect Jollibee. Its business is in food. So that will affect them. They cannot just rely on takeouts forever. So we have to be sure that they will be able to recover. So yung mga ganong bagay. Especially at this time na lahat ng stocks nagbagsakan. So pagka naghahanap ka ng mura, lahat yan mura. Diba? It's going to look cheap for most of the stocks. So the thing that we need to do right now is to be able to identify which of these cheap stocks will be able to recover and which will be potentially slower in recovery or might not be able to recover. So ganun. So Basically, that's it. I just run through ko lang. No? Again, kung wala pa kayong accounts, if you haven't opened your accounts yet, how do you get started? So, it's easy, especially in this time of ECQ, you are able to open your accounts online. So, we've gone paperless. And so, you just need to follow these three easy steps when it comes to opening an account. So, visit our website, complete the online form, and upload your documents online. So, you can easily do that and open your very own stock trading account. There are lots of value plays right now in the stock market. You just need to get started, no? to select the best. If you do open an account, I'd also like to invite you to join the Facebook group of First Metro Securities. Also like our page, join our community. So you'll learn a lot of good stuff there. And in addition to that, so if you enjoyed this, we have more videos like this in our YouTube page. So you can subscribe to it. Just click subscribe and you will gain access to all of our different tutorial videos, educational videos out there. So basically, that's it for me for tonight. But I think we have time for a few questions.
Ayun. All right. Thank you, Robbi, for the very informative discussion. No? So guys, mm-hmm. kung meron kayong questions, you can let me know so that I can unmute you. If you're very shy as a person, you can just chat the question. I'm going to ask Robbi your question. So let me know. Ako meron din akong mga tanong. And okay lang ba na ako ang magtanong? Sige. So, Robbi, when it comes to stock market kasi, one of the things na tinatanong ng mga tao, and sometimes it's very opinionated din yung mga sagot. When we say long term, how many years ba talaga when we say long term? Is it 5 years, 7 years, 10 years? Ano ba talaga siya? Is there like a formal number of years when you say long term, or depende lang sa person? Unmute.
Ayan. Okay. Ayan. Thanks. So, madami kasi talagang definitions of long term in our industry, no? Long term means 1 year. Kasi yung mga stock picks namin minsan, pagka 1 year ang duration yan, that's already long term. Because ang rationale dun is that since we cannot effectively predict naman the future, kasi speaking from the perspective of a company that generates research reports, so when we recommend stocks, long term sa amin is 1 year lang. Kasi it is our job to keep reviewing this company whether it has remained the same. Diba? Its status, its fundamentals have remained the same. And so from that perspective, long term is 1 year. But generally for investors, long term means more than, usually, maybe more than 3 years, but usually more than 5 years. No, if better kung 7 to 8 years. Kasi you would likely be able to complete a whole parang business cycle na. Dumaan ka na sa expansion, dumaan ka na sa recession. So, it's a whole business cycle na. Kaya nga, in a way, kung talaga magmamaterialize yung view ng karamihan na this could lead to a recession, it definitely might present a good opportunity for people to start investing. Not necessarily right now, as in right now, kasi things can get worse pa naman from here. We're just at the beginning part of supposedly the recession, eh, di ba? So, nag-uumpisa pa lang tayo. So, hindi ko naman masabi na talagang invest today na today. But you can start investing today in small amounts. Kasi we can never know naman din the bottom. And I think you will be thanking yourself 3-5 years from now, kasi most likely makaka-recover naman tayo dito, especially with with the government interventions worldwide. Tapos ang bilis ng pag-develop ng mga vaccine, 'di ba, ng treatment. So private sector, public sector nagtutulungan. So I think this is a very good idea. This is a very good chance to invest right now and hold it long term. Kasi in five years from now, you might be really thanking yourself na, uy, I made a lot of money. Similar to those who invested in 2009. And in 2013, they would have made triple their money already. Diba? Parang ganun. Not saying it will happen, pero yun yung business cycle. Recession, then ano, recovery.
Okay. So, generally, it's around 5 years. Pero kung gusto mo talaga longer term, 7 to 8 years para natapos mo yung isang stock market cycle. No, you went through the phases na siya.
Yeah.
All right. Sige. Another thing is.
By the way, additional lang. Sige. Additional lang. When we say long term kasi doesn't. Long term means you want to invest for the long term talaga. You select companies and you invest in them for the long term. But that doesn't necessarily mean na you don't look at your portfolio na or you become too stubborn when it comes to rebalancing your portfolio. You still have to regularly check your portfolio to see if the stock that you bought is still fit to be in to be held for the long term. Kasi nagbabago ang fundamentals niyan. Di ba? Ngayon, si Jollibee is definitely a good option long term. Kasi siguro naman makaka-recover talaga siya. No, seems like it. The management is good. The brand is strong. Even now, may demand pa naman. So, how much more pag bumalik? So, ganun siya. Pero, 10 years from now, that might not be the case. And so, you cannot just stubbornly say na, no, favorite ko si Jollibee. Long-term ako dyan. I will never sell Jollibee. So, we cannot be that stubborn. Just because we are long-term investors doesn't mean we don't have the responsibility of looking at our portfolio and looking at them and reviewing them periodically to see whether they are still fit to be held by us or they should be sold na.
All right. Got it. Yeah. Pagdating sa balanced portfolio, so meron tayong, you can invest in stocks, you can also invest sa index, no, sa PSEI. And meron ka ring cash reserve. So, for you, is there a specific percentage that this portfolio, so you have a 100% portfolio, how much percentage should be allocated to stocks? How much percentage should be allocated to index or funds? Meron bang ganun or depende talaga sa investor?
Depende na talaga siya in terms of the weighting that you will give. Pero ano siya, parang it should be part of every investor's portfolio to have an index fund because it can act as your parang core portfolio. So you want to invest in the stock market, you believe the stock market is a good long-term investment, so you invest in an index fund because that represents essentially the best companies in a stock market na. But aside from that, if you are able to identify the sectors, the industries, and more specifically the companies that will grow faster in the future, that's where you go overweight. That's where you become selective. In percentage terms, usually yung ginagamit na iba is 50 to 60% nasa index. Tapos yung remaining 50 or 40, they divide it into maybe 10 stocks or 15 stocks na kung long term sila.
Mm-hmm.
Yung ganun. So that's what some people do.
So at the end of the day, magdepende pa rin talaga sa tao kung ano talaga yung diskarte nila.
Yes, kung saan ka talaga comfortable. Kaya it really is important that you understand yung point ng bawat pinag-iinvestan mo. So, bakit ba ako mag-i-invest sa index? Why would I invest in an index fund? Because it's generally the safest. Mm-hmm. Di ba? It's generally the safest in the sense na it already contains the 30 biggest companies. So, you are well-diversified from that perspective. Especially if you believe that eventually all stock markets recover in the future, which so far, thankfully, they have done.
Yeah.
Tapos, now, aside from that, where am I comfortable investing? Am I a conservative investor that I want dividends lang? Because if so, I would probably need to invest in utility companies like PLDT, Globe, Meralco, Aboitiz Power, because they might not grow too much, pero at least I will get regular dividends. And those mm-hmm. constitute part of my returns pa din naman. But if I am aggressive naman, I can choose to invest in sectors that are high growth. In which case, pwedeng, yan, yung kayang mag-expand even overseas. Like, sila, right now, sila Jollibee, URC, on a smaller level, pwedeng si Frutas. Kunwari, si Frutas. It's a small company, but it's expanding, it's diversifying. So, yun yung mga considerations mo. So, it really will depend on how, on the risk tolerance of the investor. But definitely, it's a good idea to dabble into individual stock picking then, because there's a lot of money to be made then from there.
All right. Got it. Guys, maybe you have questions. Anne, Art, Dan, and Joanna. If you have questions, you can type it in or you can unmute yourself. No? And kung wala pa kayong tanong, ako, magtatanong ulit ako.
Sige, bro. No problem.
Ganito, boss. So, EPS, earnings per share, the higher it is, especially on a consistent basis, it's a good sign for the company in a way na, okay, this company is consistently earning, so that's a good sign. And meron din tayong PB ratio, price to book value, and we can use that as our ano rin, parang reference or guide, no? Whether if the stock is undervalued or not, and PE is something kung ano yung demand niya sa market. Mm-hmm. So kasi pagdating sa investing, we need to compare apples to apples. Mm-hmm. So is it safe to say na, let's say, BDO and BPI, both companies are good and we know talaga that these brands are good for the long term. But sometimes kasi ang nangyayari sa mga tao is that in general, ang nangyayari is that we get confused because nga, the numbers are good with these two companies and they are good in brand. So how do you detach your logic, ikaw mismo? How do you detach your logic with the emotions? Na, you know, you got all these information. You've written them down on paper, but at the end of the day, you know na pero hindi mo pa rin gusto gawin because of your emotions. Maybe natatakot tayo or maybe we're gonna make a wrong decision. How do you go through those things, you know, the process of that? Maybe you have something to share.
Yeah. Pagkadating kasi sa ganun, yun, dun papasok talaga yung first of all, yung data. That's exactly what the ROE is for. In terms of who is able to generate more profits for shareholders, based on the numbers, si BDO yun kumpara kay BPI. So that's one aspect where you can decide. However, others don't decide by that because others, yun nga, they use their emotions to decide. Parang, ay, mabait yung customer service. Mas komportable ako sa BPI kasi may numbering system agad sila. Yun dati, nung wala pa si BDO, kawari, yung mga ganun. Or may preference. Oy, gusto ko si BDO kasi nasa malls yung mga locations nila. Mas convenient for me. Yung mga ganun. It's fine in that regard, especially pero siguro dapat na view mo muna yung numbers. Kasi kung ang pinagpipilian mo lang naman is BDO and BPI or BDO and Metrobank and BPI, medyo mahirap naman na ding magkamali doon. Meron lang yung lag. Pwedeng may isa dyan sa tatlo ang mas malaki kitain kesa dun sa iba. Pero hindi ibig sabihin na lugi ka naman dun sa dalawa. So kikita ka pa din pero mas malaki lang yung kita mo sa iba. So you can usually it's all about earnings. You should decide with earnings in mind. Which of the three has the biggest potential to generate more earnings? And how do you generate more earnings in the banking industry? Kunwari, of course, you have to be aggressive, siguro. You have to have the locations, aggressive sa, or sa telco industry, kunwari, Globe PLDT. So whoever covers the more areas all over the country will probably get the market share. So katulad nun, dito, I'm using Globe kasi nauna sila magkaroon ng Globe fiber dito kaysa PLDT. So may mga ganong factor. So you can look at the aggressiveness. You can look at which company is looking to gain more market share, because market share is important, because that gives you the new customers, the new business needed to grow the earnings year after year. So yun yung pwede natin talagang tingnan. I don't think merong way na parang maging truly, purely emotional when it comes to smart investing. Eh. You really have to base it on the data that you see. Mahirap yung porket favorite mo lang talaga. Ano, kasi you have to look at the big picture talaga. That's the value of looking at the figures. Eh. You're able to see quickly kumusta ba yung kumpanya na ito, na hindi limited dito lang sa Davao, na hindi limited dun sa area kung saan, kung sa branch na kung saan lang ako pumapasyal, but complete view talaga of the company itself.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So that it really takes time to study the company, no? So yeah.
Kung especially it become the longer your time horizon, the more it is demanded out of you to study the company intimately. Pagka kasi pa-shorter term ka ng pa-shorter term, eventually, if you're a short-term investor kasi, eventually, papunta ka ng papunta sa momentum. Eh. And yung momentum, it's a bit easier to identify, because you just look at which stocks have high volume. Yung most active in a day. Most active, top traded, yung mga high flyers. And then look at the volume, look at stocks na may mataas na PE ratio, because that's the kaya mas madami ang interested maging traders, kasi what is really happening is what they see, 'di ba? It doesn't demand a lot of expertise, kasi even if you're not really that good at analyzing a particular industry, as long as you know na, uy, everyone is buying this stock, so I will join too. Parang ganun.
Yeah.
So, pagka naman long term, you don't care about the volatilities in the near term. So, you need to make sure that you're investing in a company that will be making money 5 years from now. And that's very hard to do. Even experts have a hard time doing that. And so, you really have to have a lot of faith in a company to invest in it for the long term.
So faith in the company and faith in ourselves that hopefully we make the right decision.
Yeah, kaya kailangan ka mag-rebalance. Pero ano naman, it over time you will see naman, katulad nun, there are lots of research reports right now that really yun palang listahan ng government on which industries they identify as essential and non-essential. That should already give you an idea. Katulad ni Century Pacific, the makers of Century Tuna, their earnings jumped by 31% year on year, the first quarter. Basta positive. So all the other companies were losing money. But Century's earnings were positive for the first quarter of 2020. Mostly because they were not essentially part of the lockdown. They were allowed to operate. They were deemed an essential business. And so even if all the other factories are yung mga factories ng damit, factories ng sapatos, factories ng glass, ng hardware, lahat yon nagsara, pero sila, essential sila, nag-ooperate pa din sila. And so they were still profitable. So ganun.
All right.
So we can use those things.
Cool. Got it. Meron tayong question from Anne. Ikaw na lang mag-ask ng question, sir. Ay, hindi pala siya tanong. Statement pala yun. Ito, from Dan. Sabi naman ni Dan is, sir, for a beginner there's a minimum amount of money needed to start investing in stocks.
Okay.
So, sige, ano mo doon?
In terms of the minimum kasi, talagang it's really cheap. You can buy stocks for as low as, depende sa company, depende sa price ng stock. But let's say kung meron kang 2,000 or 3,000 pesos, you can already invest in pretty good companies there. So, kung yun lang ang usapan, mura lang talaga siya. You don't need a lot of money. But when it comes to the minimum in the sense na how much of your total money right now would you invest in the stock market? Siguro yun, yung, especially since you're part of the present course, no? So I'm sure probably by now or later on, you will learn about the value of emergency funds, di ba?
Yeah.
So, dapat meron ka nun. Usually kasi 6 months. Ngayon, mas madaling maintindihan kung bakit importante na meron kang 3 to 6 months na emergency fund. Kasi we are now seeing institutions in Davao that are closing or that are laying off people because of this pandemic. So, we just want to protect ourselves from that. So, meron ka nung, yan, emergency fund. Of course, you need to have your insurance, life, medical. Tapos, after nun, once you've addressed that, so, kung may 100,000 ka, tas na-address mo na yung lahat ng yun, 3 to 6 months, emergency, insurance, yung matitira, might be a good idea to put it in the stock market. Or invest it in any asset class, no? So pwede ka mag real estate, stock market. Ang kagandahan lang din kasi sa stock market yun, it doesn't require a lot of capital. 5,000 pesos you can start investing na. So it's that small.
True. As of now, if you have 5,000 pesos, you can actually buy 100 shares of pure gold, you know. If you're talking about right now, 47.80 yung price ng pure gold ngayon.
Yeah,
Which I'm happy about it a little bit.
Yon, di ba? because di ba, that's what we talked about before. This is an industry. This is a company that belongs to an industry that is likely not going to benefit, but will not be as affected as other industries. And so, what happened? Pure gold went up from 30 something to 40 something.
Yes.
Di ba?
Okay. Ito rin, boss, definitely medyo bago lang to na news, no? And this is actually a question from, you know, one of the questions we got from the present, ang hindi sa community ng 5Ms.
Mm-hmm.
Ang tanong niya is, boss, or like, Sir John, ano sa tingin mo ang mangyari sa GMA stocks with the ABS-CBN shutdown? So,
okay.
Ano ba?
Okay. So, I think by now, if you notice, no, ever since na shutdown si ABS, there's been a lot of talk about opening it again, di ba? Nagsalita na yung Malacanang na sana ma-reconsider, tapos nagsalita na yung NTC na they're just doing their job, tapos yung Congress nagsalita na din na kung binigay lang sana ng mas maaga, yung mga stuff like that. So, ang dami. So, from that perspective, no, I believe that baka maibalik naman talaga mag-grant ng bagong franchise or at least ma-extend muna yung current franchise niya. So, babalik siya. And if babalik siya, then we could probably expect GMA stocks to revert back to their previous price before the shutdown. Kasi the only... yun kasi when it comes to investing, especially in this case na in a way speculative siya, in a way news, purely news driven siya, definitely it's not medyo news driven talaga siya. So if the reason for a stock going up is invalidated, then probably it will go back to its previous level. So ganun yun nangyari, umakyat si GMA dahil ang expectation ng tao is pag wala ang ABS, lahat na or malaking market share mapupunta sa kanya kasi hindi naman lahat kaya mag-YouTube or mag-broadband para manood ng TV Patrol. So, pupunta sa kanila. Pero now that there are some forces acting to make sure that ABS is able to operate again, bumabagsak ulit yung presyo ni GMA. So, ganun lang siya. So, the reason for it going up, which is the shutdown, is now starting to look less likely than before. Then, so it's going down further na ulit. It's reverting back to its price from before the shutdown.
Yeah. Good, good. So, yun nga, maraming naging emotional sa, ano, di ba? Maraming artista, you know, they are posting on Facebook and Instagram. Mm. And, basta grabe, gulo. Ang raming news. Ito, meron tayong question from Joanna Blanca. Hello, Sir Robbi. Since value investing ang topic, is a falling knife an indicator na goodbye ang isang stock like ABS?
Well, generally kasi yung falling knife, it's not really a recommended strategy because that's why it has a name with very negative connotations, di ba? Falling knife, because you really don't know if you will catch the handle or the knife itself. It could either end up good for you na you catch it properly, or it could end up piercing through your hand, di ba? So that's the same thing with stocks that are rapidly going down. They are rapidly going down for some reason, mostly good reason. And in the case of ABS, actually, hindi pa naman natin masasabi na ABS is a falling knife kasi it's been suspended, di ba? It's suspended, so wala pang trading na nangyayari since the shutdown. So we don't know when the suspension, I'm not sure if may update na, pero right now, I'm not sure if there has been an update on when the suspension will be lifted. But in case it's lifted with the channel still being in limbo, pwede talaga siyang bumagsak. As to whether it's a good strategy to catch a falling knife, kung sasaluhin mo siya with the intention of holding it for a week, 2 weeks, or whatever, I would not suggest it because it's going to be very volatile. But if you want to trade it, di ba? If you're going to go down in your price charts to, instead of the daily chart, you go to 5-minute or 15-minute chart, okay lang yun. Kasi you'll just trade it. Because masarap i-trade yan kasi volatile siya. So it's going to be volatile. So it's good to trade it. But if you're catching it with the hopes of buying it at good value, at deep value, medyo mahirap siya. Diba? So you might want to consider buying it near its support at around, I think the support is 12 pesos. Mm-hmm. You might want to buy it at that level. Other than that, yon, it's generally not a good strategy. No, this is a typical good strategy. It's better to wait for a stock to consolidate. No, it's better to wait for a stock to consolidate. Especially in this case, na pag na-shutdown talaga siya, what's their next strategy? They lose a lot of, masa yung market nila. Di ba? It's the mass market. Yeah. And those are the people that might not have access to broadband. Pero sila yung nagpapatronize. Sila yung target markets ng advertisers mo. So, mahirap mawala yun. Ganun.
Got it. Mm-hmm. Joanna, hopefully na-answer yun. We have a question from Anne. Tanong na nito is, what if mutual funds? So, I think what she's referring to is, magkano ba yung like minimum amount to start investing in a mutual fund?
The minimum amount, actually, there are lots of funds right now that require just 1,000 pesos to start investing. So it's that it's that cheap, actually. It's that affordable. So yun, 1,000. 1,000 you can invest in the blue chips, in the 30 blue chip companies in the PSEI already. Very cheap.
Ganun. Mm-mm. So at least meron ka ng nakastart ka na mag-invest. Okay, so Anne, hopefully na answer yun. Ito, another question would be this. Is there like a specific percentage, or again, magdepende rin siguro sa investor, but for you, is there a specific percentage na when you hit this loss, no? When you hit a certain percentage of losing money in your portfolio, portfolio in a specific stock, you would say na, hey guys, pag 20% na ganit yung loss ng stock na yun, I think it's time for you to sell it. Or is there like that kind of black and white thing? Mm-hmm. Or again, magdepende pa rin talaga sa industry?
The simple answer would be just don't let it exceed 10%. Yeah. So 10% should be your line in the sand, kumbaga your hardest limit. So dapat hindi na pwede lumagpas sa 10% yung loss mo.
As other than that,
it gets harder and harder kasi to recover pagka nag-i-increase eh, yung the math of gains and losses. It gets harder and harder to recover from losses the larger your loss is. Pagka nalugi ka ng 50% kasi, tapos tsaka ka magbebenta, kailangan mo makumita ng 100% to break even.
Yes.
Mahirap kumita ng doble na, di ba? So, doble na yung kailangan mo. Whereas, pag nalugi ka ng 10%, you just need to make 11% to break even. So, if you lose 5%, you just need to make 5% to break even. So, it gets simpler. So, don't let it exceed 10%. Pero wag naman din sigurong sobrang tight na parang 2% yung loss mo. So, siguro 5 to 7% would be the sweet spot in that regard.
Alright. So, ganun. Ito, if wala nang tanong, this is going to be my last question. So, kanina, Robbi, may pinakita ka na slide about max, yung where meron yung mga ROE, yung PE ratio, ganun. Merong part doon na sa 2015, parang negative 940.84. Parang out. Parang ano ba? Ano sa Tagalog yun? Parang, kumbaga outlier. Sa Bisaya? Parang outlier. Oh, nasa outlier. Abis siya. Bakit ganun? Anong nangyari?
Actually, check. Sige, let's check. Ayun. Wait. Sorry.
Yan. Yan.
Yeah. So that's the PE ratio.
Yeah. PE ratio, so bakit 940?
Negative earnings, lugi. Negative earnings. Kasi 'di ba the formula of PE ratio is price over EPS. EPS is earnings per share. So kung net income 'yan, net income divided net income less preferred dividends divided by number of outstanding shares. So if net income is positive, positive din yung sagot mo. Pagka net loss ka, negative yung sagot mo. So net negative siya. So lugi siya nung taon na yan, kaya siya negative.
Yun. Okay. Yun ganun.
Yes.
Sige. Kaya baka may ano lang may mga magtaka ba na hala, ang layo ng 18.32.1640 then negative na 40 yes. Ano nangyari?
Tsaka back there, yun, lugi talaga siya. Lugi siya nun. Kaya negative yung ano niya, yung PE ratio niya.
Sige. So ganito, sa last thing siguro, for me, the best learnings talaga is at the end of the day, nasa investor pa rin kung ano yung diskarte niya, how he or she is going to manage his or her emotions, no, when it comes to investing. So, any last thing that you want to say before we end the call?
Yeah, okay. So, yun. So, yun. Perfect talaga yung sinabi mo. Kasi, investing is, ganito kasi talaga yung investing. It's really fluid. No? As much as I believe some of you might want more direct or more straight to the point answers in the sense na you would immediately know what you want to do afterwards. It's not the case with investing kasi nga talagang it caters to different approaches. Kaya I really, yun, I'm glad Sir John gave the opportunity for me to hold multiple sessions kasi I wanted to let you see the different approaches when it comes to investing. Yung first session natin was from the approach of someone who is riding the momentum, meaning sumasabay sa demand. And so, sila yung typically mas aggressive. Okay lang na mahal. Basta in demand siya. Basta binibili ng tao. Ganun yung point nun. So, para lang i-simplify natin. Last week, ang point was aggressive. Yun yung mga aggressive investors. okay lang na mataas ang presyo niya kasi ibig sabihin ng mataas ang presyo, maraming bumibili. Doon ko gusto. Ito naman, yung this week's session, this is for the conservative na ayoko ng mahal. I really avoid expensive stocks. I really avoid the popular stocks. I want to invest in companies that are cheaper than they really are, than their true value. So the reason I do that is because it gives me more room for error, yung margin of safety. It gives me more upside, more potential upside, while also severely limiting my downside. It is very hard to make a mistake if, di ba, parang in the same way when we shop, di ba, bakit minsan may sapatos, di ba, 5,000 pesos yung sapatos. Sa 5,000, gusto mo, pero napapaisip ka pa. Nagdadalawang isip ka pa. Pero yung 5,000, pero gusto mo. Pero yung sapatos na 5,000 naging 1,500, di ba ang sasabihin mo, no-brainer na. No-brainer na siya. Sobrang mura na siya. Kailangan, minsan, di ba, parang minsan ako ganun, parang kailangan ko na yan bilhin kasi masyadong mura. Parang ako na yung mali pag hindi ko pa yan binili. Parang ganun. So, ganun lang din yung approach ng value investors. Masyado na siyang mura for its value. I need to buy it now because it's very, very unlikely I will be making a mistake in buying this at this price. So, ganun siya. So, yun lang. So, hopefully, I've made things clearer lang kasi essentially, yun lang naman talaga siya. Aggressive, conservative. Meron lang tayong ways to measure the aggressiveness or the conservativeness, but at the end of the day, the other approach is aggressive. This one is conservative. So, ganun.
Sige. Pahabol lang na question.
Yeah,
Before we end, so Ann, Art, Dan, Joanna, if you have a question pa, so ito na yung last chance natin to ask a question. No? So, ang question ko, Robbi, is this. For me, this is one of the things that I do. One of the things that I look out for is really the earnings of the company for like how many years, no? Usually, I look at 5 years and sometimes I also connect it with the charts. So, sometimes I look at the charts for 6 months or a year or 3 years and see the pattern lang naman. Hindi naman talaga siya big factor. Kasi nga, from our first session, the earnings of a company will also affect the stock price of a company. So usually what happens kung maganda talaga yung presyo ng maganda yung earnings, then most probably aakyat yung stock price. So how about for those companies na medyo hindi consistent yung earnings or at least man lang medyo pangit yung takbo ng earnings sila for 3 years. Like sometimes it's negative, then positive this year, negative, then positive na naman. In your case, or in your opinion, is your money safe to invest in that specific stock knowing that the income is not consistently growing, fluctuating siya?
Basically, hindi. From that perspective, hindi. Kasi why would you invest in a company? Kasi speaking from the perspective of an investor, why would you invest in a company that you are not sure will be able to make money this year? Diba? Siguro, the first thing we need to do is we have to find out why is it inconsistent when it comes to its earnings? Although the mere fact na inconsistent siya, ano na yun eh, medyo kaduda-duda na. Kasi parang, di ba, kumita ako last year, tapos, what could I have done to make that huge a mistake so much so that I suddenly lose money this year? Di ba? Tapos the next year, I make money ulit. Tapos the next year, I lose money ulit. Parang, ganun ba ka-volatile yung industry where I belong to? Walang loyalty yung customers ko na when do they buy me? Do they only buy me when things are bad? Or when, parang ganun, di ba? Kasi supposedly, si di ba yung course si Jollibee, nagtataas yan ng nagtataas ng presyo every year, but people still patronize it because there is the reputation, the goodwill generated for the company. So pagka ang isang kumpanya ganun ka inconsistent, baka mahina ang management, walang goodwill, walang loyalty yung company, prone to different business cycles. So we have to find out the reasons why then. Kaya lang kung ganun yung case na 4 years, 5 years na siyang up down, hindi din talaga na siya okay. Simply yeah. put, hindi siya okay. You should be able to find companies that are better than that, na consistent ang growth ng earnings. So most likely din, hindi ka kikita dyan kasi other investors will feel the same way. And they won't buy that stock. So ganun yeah. siya. Mm-mm.
Kasi ang thinking
may,
kasi...
May particular company ba? Do you have, or wala?
Wala naman. Wala naman. So far based on the stocks that I'm looking at, medyo consistent naman talaga siya. Pero wala lang. Parang dumating lang siya sa mind ko. Kasi ako personally, I wouldn't... That's the answer kung ako yung tatanungin. Mm. I'm not confident to invest in those companies up-down. Parang it's a no-brainer. If you have your own business, you also want your business to grow constantly. Yeah. Kung ganun-ganun siya, parang, hey, what's going on with your business,
parang,
right?
From a personal level, kung tayo yung business people, hindi naman din tayo magtatayo ng business na, di ba, yung parang, this year kikita ako, next year pwedeng malugi ako. Nang wala namang walang external forces. Talagang because of management lang talaga, di ba? So it cannot be that volatile.
So, kasi ang thinking na kasi ng iba, hello sir, since bababa siya sir, ngayon yung earnings niya, kung mag-invest kami, meron silang fund na pwede gagamitin so that ipa-earn nila or ipa-grow nila yung business. So kung mag-grow yung business, yung investment ko, aakyat rin.
No. Oo. Actually, ano na yan, hindi na siya pwede kasi na-issue na yung shares so sa secondary market. So the company basically only generated money from the IPO. So kung nag-IPO si Jollibee, let's say si, kumari lang, nag-IPO si SM ng, or si Jollibee na lang, nag-IPO si Jollibee ng 1 million shares at 5 pesos per share dati. So yung na-raise niyang capital for Jollibee is 5 million pesos. So even if all things remaining the same, even if 200 pesos or 100 pesos na si Jollibee ngayon, kahit mag-invest ka ngayon kay Jollibee, hindi mapupunta kay Jollibee yung 100 pesos mo. You would be buying it from someone else. So yung capital ni Jollibee, it was during the IPO.
Yeah.
So magtataka or you might be asking, so bakit pa, so what's the, why are companies concerned with growing the stock price if they don't make money from it na pala now? It's because they need to, aside from the fact na pagka kumikita ang stocks mo, sikat ka, di ba? Sikat ka, may free publicity yan. Aside from that, what if you need capital again in the future? So dati, let's say 10 years or 15 years ago, nag-list si Jollibee, hindi pa siya ganun kasikat. So ang IPO price niya, 5 pesos per share lang, 1 million shares. 1 million shares ang ilalabas niya, 5 pesos per share, 5 million pesos yung na-generate niyang capital. Ganun. Pero ngayon, 100 na siya. So if you sell 1 million shares pa din, but it's already at 100 pesos per share, you would now be able to generate 100 million pesos. So that's the case for corporations wanting to make sure that they increase their stock price. So that when they need capital again in the future, and the companies that want to expand will always need capital, they will be able to generate capital at high, mas malaki yung pwede nilang ma-generate na capital by essentially selling a lower amount of shares to the public. Parang ganun. Yeah. Tsaka right. Minsan, nagba-buyback din naman ng mga companies ng own shares nila. So, kikita din sila. Pagka undervalued, bibili sila. Pagka mataas, bebenta nila. Parang ganun. So, pwede din yan.
All right. So far wala namang ano, wala nang pahabol na tanong. So I think that's going to be our session. Let's call it a night. Okay. Robbi, again, thank you so much no sa pag-share mo ng knowledge mo sa amin in terms of value investing naman yung topic natin ngayon and for the Q&A. So ano ba ba? So guys, again, Robbi is connected sa First Metro Securities. It's one of the brokers that I personally use. And you can open an account online yung napakita niya kanina if you want to start trading / investing in the stock market, no? So he will be also guiding you you know, if you want to. meron namang mga chat groups and Facebook groups with First Metro Securities na mga community to talk about, you know, updates about what's happening to the stock market. Okay? So thank you so much for everybody's time, especially sa iyo, Robbi, for this session. So next week, plug ko lang, meron tayong last session, no, with Robbi pa rin. But this time, the topic is about finding the best mutual funds for you. Ayun, di ba? Parang tailor fit talaga siya for you. So, ano na, this is going to be our fourth session. Nakakahiya na.
Kailang, no problem.
Now we're
no
consuming problem. A lot of time from ano, from Robbi. Okay? So stay tuned for that, guys. It's going to be Friday at 8 p.m. still. And, you know, session is about mutual funds naman. All right. So again, bye-bye everyone and have a great night. Good night.
Bye-bye. Good night.
All right.